So it seems that Starship SN9 is pulling an SN8 on us after all. Why? Why are you doing this to us, SN9? Let's see what happened at Boca Chica and why we have to wait a bit more until we can see another Starship high altitude test flight. Then, if you want something to laugh about, we show you what happens when a fashion company thinks it has to write a piece about SpaceX's space exploration plans.
Then a really positive update on the Europa Clipper mission, and SpaceX's Dragon will carry solar arrays to the ISS. And you won't believe it, but Blue Origin is making progress! And Orion is ready to be fueled up for Artemis 1. And if you live in Russia and want Starlink, you're out of luck. There's a lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
We have some good news and some bad news for you. The good news is that Starship SN9 performed a really impressive series of static fire tests, namely 3 tests within 4 hours. But the bad news is that 2 of the 3 Raptor engines need slight repairs, so they will have to be switched now. So we all know what that means. It means that we can forget an SN9 flight in January. Back in December, we said that we would see an SN9 test flight in mid-January if everything goes well, and in early February if problems should be encountered. And now you see that problems have been encountered, so that the high altitude test flight is very likely to occur in early February. Because of course, SN9 will have to perform new static fire tests with the 2 newly installed engines. So yeah, SN9 is really pulling an SN8 on us.
I want SN9 to fly! Hulk! Hulk likes flying! Launching!
But okay, SpaceX is learning a lot in the process, and Elon also said that they are making major improvements to ease the engine swapping speed, the goal being only a few hours at most.
In other SpaceX-related news, NASA announced that SpaceX will launch new solar arrays for the ISS aboard a Dragon capsule later this year. The ISS's solar arrays are getting a bit old now and show signs of degradation, having been in constant use for 20 years. They generate some 120 kilowatts of electrical power, which would be enough to power 40 homes. But NASA wants to keep the ISS in use for another 10 years, as it appears, so that new solar panels will ensure a lasting upgraded power supply. Now, these 6 panels are under development by Boeing subsidiary SpectroLab and supplier Deployable Space Systems, pictured here. Yet, Boeing was very quick to take the credit for building the solar arrays, as we can see in this tweet here. We find it a bit ironic though that these Boeing-built solar panels will be delivered to the International Space Station on a SpaceX Dragon capsule, and not on a Starliner.
In some really good news, the Europa Clipper mission seems to have been liberated from having to be launched on an SLS rocket. We remember that the Europa Clipper was championed by former Texas Republican Representative John Carberson, who at the time was the chair of the House Appropriations Subcommittee that funds NASA. In order to get support for the Europa Clipper, Carberson added the SLS mandate, which garnered support from Alabama Republican Senator Richard Shelby, chair of the Senate Appropriations Committee. Of course, Richard Shelby liked the idea a lot, since many parts of the SLS rocket are built in Huntsville, Alabama. The new 2021 NASA fiscal funding section has now been changed in that the mandate that the Europa Clipper must be launched on an SLS will only be valid if an SLS will be available for the launch date in 2024, and only if compatibility issues between the probe and the rocket are resolved. If not, then NASA can choose from commercial alternatives, and you know that there's only one currently, namely SpaceX's Falcon Heavy. SLS would have had enough power to send the Clipper on a direct route to Jupiter, but Falcon Heavy is less powerful than the SLS, with 65 instead of 95 metric tons to LEO. Therefore, an additional kick stage will be required for the Falcon Heavy if we want the Clipper to arrive at Jupiter as fast as possible. But still, using Falcon Heavy instead of SLS will save NASA a relaxed $1.5 billion. Not bad. In our opinion, it entirely depends on how many SLSs will be needed for the Artemis program, and also on how Starship will look in 2024. Because should Starship and Super Heavy be flight ready by that time, which we think it will, then it could launch the Europa Clipper even more easily to Jupiter.
And please subscribe to our channel, because we are one of the very few space channels who dare to speak openly about space politics and corruption in the spaceflight industry. Thank you very much in advance. In other news, if you want to laugh a bit about what weird connections people sometimes like to make up between quite different things, we have a funny article for you written by a fashion company that sells clothes and shoes and stuff like that, namely Highsnobiety. So they are totally qualified to write about spaceflight, of course. The title of this high-quality piece of journalism being "Trust Elon Musk to make going to space sound shit." In this very intelligent article, the writer compares the notion of becoming a multi-planetary species and settling Mars to colonialism. Now, why would anyone compare these two totally different things to each other? Well, because Elon once put out the idea that people that cannot afford the $100,000 ticket price to Mars, in the future when regular flights to Mars will be commonplace, that these people will be able to take a loan and work on Mars to pay back their loan. Now, in the article, the writer likens this to indentured servitude in the early 17th century, where indentured servitude was set up as early as 1607 in order to attract a cheap workforce to the new colonies in North America. An indentured servant had to work under pretty bad conditions, and their contracts could be extended as punishments. Now, comparing that completely different time to offering a way to get to Mars for people that cannot fork over $100,000 easily is a bit of a stretch here. But we guess hating on Elon seems to be a trend for some people these days, you know? Neolites. Sorry. Yeah, let's hate on the guy that revived the electric car and forces all other car makers to also go electric, thereby accelerating our transition to sustainable energy. Let's hate on the guy that wants to save humanity from certain extinction by enabling human habitation of other planets. Let's hate on the guy that drives forward renewable energy with Tesla solar and power walls. Let's hate on this ass who wants to protect humanity from an AI apocalypse by having us merge with AI. Let's hate on him because he wants to solve traffic congestion by building cheap tunnels. What an asshole, seriously. What? And now he wants to enable low-income people to be able to start a new life on Mars? What an asshole! Anyways, back on topic, namely Blue Origin turns out is also doing a bit of stuff. But hey, you didn't really think we meant New Glenn, did you? No. That thing is of course still years away. No, we're talking about their tiny new Shepard suborbital rocket, which is designed to launch a few people up to the Kármán line, about 100 kilometers above Earth, so right above the edge of our atmosphere where space begins. Now, on January 14th, Blue Origin performed the 14th test flight of their new Shepard suborbital rocket, which apparently now is the final test flight before the first real flights with space tourists can commence in April this year. Prototype engine and vehicle flights of New Shepard began in 2006, while full-scale engine development started in the early 2010s and was complete by 2015. Uncrewed test flights of the complete New Shepard vehicle began in 2015.
Okay, cool. So 15 years of development time for a suborbital rocket. That's really not bad. It's really good. It's nice. Nice. I mean, hey, SpaceX had the first flight of a Falcon 1 also back in 2006, with the slight difference that they now are flying astronauts to the ISS since last year on the Falcon 9 rocket, a much more capable rocket than the Falcon 1. And SpaceX also has the Falcon Heavy, currently the world's strongest rocket, which has already flown 3 times. And they have a next-generation Super Heavy class fully reusable rocket and spaceship in development, called Starship and Super Heavy. But hey, we get 15 years of development time for a suborbital reusable rocket that will totally not change anything for humanity. It's also not so bad. Not so bad. It's actually quite impressive, we'd say. Talking of very long development times, it seems that the Orion capsule is now finally ready to fuel up for the Artemis 1 mission. With its assembly complete, teams are moving Orion to the next facility for fueling and officially transferring the spacecraft to NASA's Exploration Ground Systems team, responsible for processing Orion for its launch later this year. Nice. But hey, still faster than Blue Origin, because Orion began testing back in 2009, so only 12 years from first tests to the first launch on top of the rocket it had been intended for. Orion already performed an unmanned test flight in 2014 on a Delta IV Heavy, where it actually went to space already and successfully splashed down in the Pacific Ocean 4.5 hours after launch. For the Artemis 1 mission, Orion will perform an uncrewed test flight around the moon.
And now some really bizarre news. Now, we know that the Russian government aren't exactly fans of SpaceX, right? We know that the chief of the Russian space agency Roscosmos is especially not a fan of SpaceX, making repeatedly some unfriendly remarks about them. Starlink, Rogozin said last August, is part of a, quote, a rather predatory, clever, powerful, high technology policy of the USA, which uses shock and awe in order to advance, before all, their military interests.
We wonder why he would say such things. Could it have something to do with the fact that SpaceX is completely and utterly destroying the core business of Roscosmos by taking over their whole market share? Might it have something to do with that? We guess yes. So anyways, Rogozin seems to have done a good job in persuading other Russian government officials that Starlink is really not good for Russia. Thus, the Russian legislative state body, the Duma, is proposing fines for any citizen using Starlink. Well, that is quite unfortunate for the many Russian citizens in this vast country who could really profit from high bandwidth internet. We guess you don't usually have 100 megabits per second download and 20 milliseconds of latency time in the rural parts of Siberia. Sad to see such development. But hey, Russians are some very intelligent and inventive people. So we are pretty sure that they will find intelligent ways to use Starlink without being fined.
And on this occasion, we'd like to thank again all the people that help us. For example, Shabo Yare for helping us tremendously with the subtitles.
And we also want to thank another space nut, Framrick, Jay Keegan, Miko, Rich LV, and MLLT for helping us to manage our Discord server.
And of course, we'd like to thank Michael Rood and Jay Keegan for developing our website. Thank you so much.
And you, our dear viewers. We of course want to thank you for watching the JI Space Report.
I think Hulk also wants to thank the viewers.
And Hulk also wants to thank you. And then I would say, on to the future.
SN9!
Amazing! Mostly Neo-Luddites. But, you know. What? How should I say it?
It sounded like ants.
What?
It sounded like ants. On to the future.
Oh, it was too late.